When I was a child, ladies and gentlemen, I was a dreamer. And I read comic books and I was the hero of the comic book. I saw movies and I was the hero in the movie. So every dream that I ever dreamed has come true 100 times.
Memories sweeten through the ages just like wine. Quiet thoughts come floating down and sell softly to the ground like all of autumn leaves around my feet. I touch them and they burst apart with sweet. Memories, sweet memories of holding hands and red bouquets, eyes trimmed with purple haze, and laughing eyes and simple ways, and quiet nights and gentle days with you. Between the pages of my mind, memories sweeten through the ages just like wine. Memories.
Yes, Elvis left us with so many great memories. They'll always be pressed between the pages of our minds. My name is Wink Martindale, and this is Elvis Memories. The host of this show is an old friend of mine, George Klein, a longtime radio and television personality from Memphis, Tennessee. George first met Elvis at Humes High School, and they remained close personal friends for 28 years. As a matter of fact, George was one of 14 people at Elvis's wedding. And Elvis was George's best man. George was in many of Elvis's movies, remaining true and loyal to Elvis until the King's untimely death. George Klein, a man who knew, a man who loved Elvis Presley.
Welcome to Elvis Memories. Join us as we present some exclusive stories, beautiful photographs, rare, never-before-seen film footage, reflections of the man that changed all of our lives. We'll be talking to some of Elvis's best friends, relatives, and former associates. You'll see people like his fiance, Ginger Alden, Mr. Guitar, Chet Atkins, pop music's Dick Clark, movie actress Donna Douglas, television personality David Frost, singing star Mickey Gilley, country music star Merle Haggard, the killer himself, Jerry Lee Lewis, entertainer of the year, Miss Barbara Mandrell, TV host, Wink Martindale, male singer of the year, Roddy Millsap, Mr. Blue Suede Shoes, Carl Perkins, Elvis's uncle, Vester Presley, the great Jerry Reed, Silver Fox, Charlie Rich, movie actress, Sybil Shepherd, singer, T.G. Shepherd, the legendary Hank Snow, singer-songwriter, Tony Joe White, a lot more, and of course, Elvis himself.
The image is one thing, and a human being is another, you know.
Well, heard the news. Well, it's good you're rocking tonight on the rock, man, rock. Well, I heard the news. There's a good you're rocking tonight. I'm gonna hold my baby as tight as I can around tonight. She'll know I'm a mighty, mighty man. I heard the news.
There's a good to rock in the night.
I say, immediately head, I hurry behind the board. But don't you be afraid that I do, you know her. I want you to bring along my rocking shoes, cause tonight I'm going to rock away all of my blues. If I heard the news,
that'd be good to rock in the night.
Afraid that I'll do you no harm. I want you to bring along my rocking shoes, cause tonight I'm going to rock away all the blues. If I heard the news,
there's a good to rock in the night.
Play it again.
He truly was one of a kind, and I don't think there'll ever be another one like him again. He truly was the king, and I guess I was awfully lucky to have been there from the very beginning. Elvis and I graduated together from Humes High School back in Memphis. He went into show business, and I became a disc jockey. Elvis frequently dropped by my radio show, as you can see in this piece of rare footage from 1956. For a while, I traveled with him, and what great memories we shared. His recording sessions, the TV shows, the movies in Hollywood, the exciting personal appearances. We went everywhere from Los Angeles to Hawaii to Canada and back. And the stories of those early days are true classics. But even from back in Humes High School, I knew there was something special about Elvis. He was different, and he always said he wasn't going to change. He was going to stay himself. He told me once, he said, "GK, my goal is the top." And of course, he made it. But once Elvis touched your life, you never seemed to be the same again. And it all started with a song.
Without Sam Phillips and Sun Records, the world perhaps may never have heard Elvis Presley. Because Elvis walked in to 706 Union to make a record for his mom on her birthday. Sam Phillips recorded that man, and history followed.
Elvis felt a real sincere desire to be honest in his music, have a little fun with it. Elvis wasn't always serious, you know better than that, George. But when you took that little quick facade off, it was unbelievable when that spiritual quality of Elvis came out.
I mean, Elvis was a rebel, but he was a rebel that he had love in his face.
When I saw him the first time, and I said it, I didn't say it to be cute. I said it because I was blown away. I'd never seen a dude that good looking. He was one of the best looking dudes, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm, sure was.
I mean, baby, when I walked in and saw it, there it was. You know, I ain't no fool. I said, yeah, damn, if you ain't the best looking thing I ever seen. Kind of wish I was a girl right now, Elvis.
On Elvis Memories with an old friend, Wink Martindale. Wink, we're going to take you back to the year 1956. Elvis did perhaps the only ever one-on-one solo television interview with you. What are your memories of that day?
That afternoon at Channel 13, you just had the feeling that something was in the air, that this guy, who had already made a movie in Hollywood and was rising to new heights and was at that time was in a step-by-step battle, so to speak, with Pat Boone, if you'll remember, for popularity. He was on all the magazine covers then, and getting bigger and bigger and bigger. You just had the feeling. You didn't know what was happening, but the electricity, George, was incredible.
How about the big show at Rustwood Park scheduled for July 4th? Bob Johnson, surely I know, wants us to mention that, and we want to mention it. I believe the proceeds from this show go to the Cynthia Milk Fund. Is that right, Elvis?
Yes, sir, that's right. And I'd like to say that we have a diamond ring that we're going to have as a door prize. It's my initial ring. I've had it for some time, and it has 14 diamonds in it. And We're going to give it away at the door as a door prize.
I see.
And everything.
And all the proceeds from this particular show, this is July 4th at Russwood Park. Elvis is going to be there. He's going to sing and play. His band will be there. Many other stars will be there, too. And we will certainly want you to watch Bob Johnson's column in the Memphis Press-Seminar, watch all the publicity on it, and get your tickets in advance. Elvis Presley, I want to thank you again because
thank
we know
you,
you're
man.
A busy man, and thanks a lot for coming by and seeing us at the dance party and saying hello to all your friends here in Memphis and the Mid-South. And anytime you're in town and want to come by, we certainly will welcome you.
Well, thank you very much, Wink, and I'll see you again.
Okay, all thanks right. a lot. Elvis Presley.
Here's the actual never-before-seen footage of that 1956 Russwood Park concert in Memphis.
Well, you may go to college, you may go to school, you may have a pink Cadillac, but don't you be nobody's fool. Now, baby, come back, baby, come. Come back, baby, come. Come back, baby, I wanna play out with you. Well, listen, let me tell you, baby, what I'm talking about. I'm all back to me, little girl, so we can play some house. Now, baby, come back, baby, come. Come back, baby, come. Come back, baby, I wanna play out with you.
I wanna play hot, baby. I wanna be hot.
Baby, well, I want you to know. Come on back and let's play a little house so we can act like we did before. Now, baby, come back, baby, come. Come back, baby, come. Come back, baby, I want to play out with you. Oh, play it again.
You didn't know what was happening, but you just knew that this man was going to become not only a superstar, but to coin a phrase and to use an overused expression, a legend in his own time. And I fortunately was involved in just a couple of little pieces of that, which I'll never forget as long as I live.
By March of 1958, Elvis was an international movie and recording star, making up to $500,000 a month. Then he received a fan letter from Uncle Sam. Elvis told me that he requested it, could have gone into special services, but he wanted to be just a regular soldier. Is that right?
He did, and there was one time we were in Graffenweer on winter maneuvers, and we were sleeping in like 3 foot of snow in our sleeping bags, and they came to Elvis at that time and said, some colonel or something, said, Mr. Presley, we're going to take you back to Miami to the disc jockey convention, and then we're going to bring you to Paris for the air show, and then we've arranged for you to meet the Pope. And Elvis went back to him. He said, gentlemen, sir, there's 15,000 men out there that are sleeping in the snow, and then for me to leave and go to a nice, warm, comfortable place and then have to come back and work with those guys, he said, I couldn't face them. He said, I think I'll just stay here.
There was a Presley era in clothes and hairstyles, you know, and he was the image of America to a lot of the world, you know, and so it was like meeting a pop psychology phenomenon rather than just a pop phenomenon, you know, and to actually see him in the flesh was, one was like back to being a fan again in a way, you know.
Elvis lived in Memphis, Tennessee. His mansion, Graceland, was a landmark even before this city renamed the street Elvis Presley Boulevard. We went behind the Graceland gates to talk to Elvis's uncle, Vester.
Vester, there was a lot of fond memories up here at Graceland. He did love his fans, didn't he?
Yes, he did, very much. And he always said to me, Uncle Vester, don't hurt those cats. They put me on this hill.
In the early years, Elvis was never too busy for his fans, especially his number one fan, his mother, Gladys Love Presley.
Fan
friends would come to the show, and girls would faint, and guys would fall out.
The first time I ever heard Elvis sing was at the old Philadelphia Arena in the mid-50s, and it was the very first time I ever heard an audience scream like that. I'll remember that reaction the rest of my life.
He was wonderful. He was a perfect gentleman. Elvis would treat a lady like a lady if she was a lady, and that's the kind of respect she would command. But if she was not, he would treat her however, you know, the situation, whatever the situation would call for is how he would react.
He was a beautiful person, a very warm person, and somebody that I'll always cherish that I got to know.
He was a real gentleman, and I think he had a gentleman's wit. I don't know how to explain that. But if he would be funny or amusing, it would never be vulgar or... He was a gentleman.
I wanted to say to Elvis Presley and the country that this is a real, decent, fine boy. And wherever you go, Elvis...
Everybody knows Elvis was probably one of the greatest guys in the world. And he was a funny man. Nobody really realized that, but he really was
a great wit.
Yeah, he had a great wit. Great sense of humor.
Very deep man religiously, really. I'm glad that people are getting into that side of him now, because he was very religious.
When he was 2 years old, he used to go to church and sing and slap his little hands, and he'd sing above all everybody else, you know, because he loved to sing then.
Well, I'm tired and weary, but I'm
passed away. There were stories going around, Elvis was this and Elvis was that, and I said, no, that's false, because I said, Elvis was a good Christian boy. He never drank, he never smoked, and I just thought he was a true example of a good American boy.
He was always appreciative of anything that you had done for him, number one, and secondly, he was charming and all I can say, old world manners.
He just never really let it go to his head. He knew he had something. I mean, gosh, I imagine all entertainers do, you know, to a certain degree. But he never really used it in a harmful way. He used it in a good way. And, you got to respect a man for that.
Mary, what was some of Elvis's favorite foods that you ladies cooked up at Graceland?
Well, he liked the hamburger steaks, roast beef for his meats. And vegetables, he liked string beans, cream potatoes, and sauerkraut.
What would be your greatest memory of Elvis?
Well, I imagine when he told us about meeting Priscilla. He told us about the beautiful girl that he had met while he was in the service and what she meant to him. And he just explained it a little bit different than what I'd ever heard a boy talk about a girl. You know, and just the way he told us about her and how beautiful she was and what all she meant to him, I think it's just one thing that I will always remember.
Elvis said later, he said, man, it's like she walked in, so I looked at her, and he said, it was like, where have you been all my life? You know, and really, I think it affected him that way.
On May 1st, 1967, Priscilla walked down that aisle. We called it Elvis's May Day, and I was there. At about 4 in the morning, Elvis and Priscilla went to the Clark County Courthouse, where Elvis paid $15 for a marriage license. Then they drove to the Aladdin Hotel and retired, with the wedding set for early that same morning.
There were only 14 people at the actual wedding, but a huge reception and press conference followed, and almost immediately the news was flashed around the world that Elvis Presley had been married. They were the picture of true love. Elvis was the happiest I'd seen him in a long, long time, and it was a dream come true for Priscilla. A 5-foot wedding cake and a massive diamond ring that Elvis's jeweler had flown in from Memphis, and attention like she'd never, ever seen before. Michelle, Priscilla's younger sister, was her maid of honor. Mr. Presley was there, as were Priscilla's parents and family. That afternoon, we all flew back to Palm Springs. Elvis and Priscilla stayed there for a short honeymoon, then settling down to life in California and Graceland in Memphis. Sweet
memories of holding hands and red bouquets, eyes trimmed with purple haze, and laughing eyes and simple ways, and quiet nights and gentle days with you.
Almost a year later, Lisa Marie Presley was born.
That was probably one of the happiest times I've ever seen Elvis. I mean, he was gleaming like, it's unexplainable. I mean, he was really, really elated.
He really loved Lisa, didn't he, John?
Oh, definitely. He wanted to give her all the love and everything that he didn't have when he was a kid. So he gave her everything. She gave her a mink coat, a little girl, a mink coat, you know. I mean, Priscilla didn't like that too much. She figured that was spoiled, so she didn't get it till much later.
Yeah. But, when she was 8 years old.
She had a diamond ring, you know, but he just loved, he loved giving things anyhow.
Elvis was many things to many people in his movies. He was loving, he was youth, he was cute, he was violent, he was happy, he was sensitive, he was sexy, and he was a genius when it came to singing. He left us with so many movie memories, 33 films in only 16 years. A great way to remember the man we still call the king.
I enjoyed working with him very, very much. You know, he's a very nice, warm person, and a very professional person.
I know he was cutting a session one time to one of the soundtracks for a movie, and the Elvis says, "I want the Jordan Harris to sing along on the chorus with me on this." Hollywood director come running in there, Jerry, and he says, "Oh no, Elvis," he says, "you don't understand where this song is going to be used in the movie." He says, "You're riding down the highway on a motorcycle when you're singing this song." Said, "Where would the voices be?" Elvis said, "The same damn place the band is."
In 1969, Elvis returned to the stage in Las Vegas. Those memories coming up.
You have any thoughts about the rising interest in country music?
I think it's fantastic. You see, country music was always a part of the influence on my type of music anyway. It's a combination of country music and gospel and rhythm and blues all combined. It's what it really was. As a child, I was influenced by all of that.
You consider yourself basically a country music singer, then?
I would hate to say strictly country because of the fact that I liked all different types of music when I was a child, you know. Of course, the Grand Ole Opry was the first thing I ever heard, probably. But I liked blues and I liked the gospel music, gospel quartets and all that.
Did you ever pull out any of those old records from the Sun label and listen to them at all?
They sound funny, boy. They got a lot of echo on them, man, I'll tell you.
It's all around your mama. That's all right with you. That's all right, your mama. Just anyway, it's Julie. That's all right. That's all right. That's all right, your mama. Anyway, it's Julie. Well, now my mama, she done told me. Papa done told me too. Son, that gal, you fool. And the way she ain't no good for you. But that's all right. That's all right. That's all right now, mama, and the way it do. Wait a minute. I say I'm leaving town, baby. I'm leaving town, but sure. Well, if any of you won't be bothered with me, hang around your door, but that's all right. That's all right. That's all right, now, mama. It's in the way it do. I did it, I did it, did it. Dee-dee-dee-dee, I don't need your loving.
That's all right.
I'm out of breath.
All right.
That's all right now, my mind. And the way you want to do.
He was the most exciting person that ever walked in the studio.
He was what he's going to always be, the king of rock and roll music. And he was the greatest. He was... You know, Elvis could sing any type of music that he wanted to sing. That's what made him so believable, and that's why he was so great as he was.
I think he's one of the greatest singers there ever was, regardless of his magnitude on stage or whatever. He had the talent to go with it, a huge talent.
See, he was the greatest singer of all time.
What was it about him that made him so great, in your opinion?
Oh, just an electrifying artist, different style. He was good. And you're good. You never take a back seat to anybody, you know. And Elvis, he never had to take a back seat. He was, when he walked out on stage, he demanded attention.
Jerry, you once told me you had several favorite rock and roll songs, but one of your all-time favorite rock and roll songs was Don't Be Cruel.
Mm-hmm.
And
really?
Why was that, Jerry?
I don't know. I just thought it was one of the greatest songs I've ever heard. And it's recorded by me.
You know I can be found sitting home all alone. If you can come around, at least please telephone.
I mean, he was the innovator. He was the one that started everything rolling. And music as we know it today stems from what Presley did when he changed everything to the beat and the type of music that he was singing and playing.
As far as rock and roll was concerned, I mean, Elvis was definitely, he was the boss. He was the one that broke open a whole field for a bunch of old cotton field boys like myself.
Elvis came out with a style of his own, and it was very creative. And once he got into it and you got that feel, Elvis just took off like a late freight. And with Elvis doing this kind of music, gave an injection to black music that no other artist had ever done.
I met him one night. He introduced himself to me and told me that he enjoyed my music and invited me out to his house. And the thing that was just so fantastic about it was the fact that a superstar would come up to somebody just really starting that really had nothing going for him and would just give you such encouragement and say, hey, I really like what you're doing. I mean, that doesn't happen. You don't see that too much from too many superstars.
He was the master of making people feel as though they knew him, although maybe they never got within a mile of him, but they would feel as though he was their friend and someone they could trust and love. And as I said, I'm no different than anyone else. I was and am a big Elvis Presley fan, and I think of all the many wonderful hours of pleasure he's given all of us.
Many years went by before I had the pleasure of meeting Elvis, but I grew up with him just like everybody else.
There's a lot of great entertainers in the world, but it's just a few, you know, that will come by and just move people with it, really not having to do nothing.
You can put a lot of people into categories, but the only category you can put him in is legend in his time and legend in our time. And I don't think I could say it any stronger than that.
A live concert, to me, is exciting because of all the electricity that's generated in the crowd and on stage.
Summer of 1969, Elvis returned to the stage, giving his first live show in 9 years at the Las Vegas International Hotel. He did two shows a night for 30 days and broke all Vegas attendance records. He became the highest paid performer in the history of show business. Critics from every media in the country agreed that Elvis was the king of entertainment. Some of my favorite home movies in this special were shot in sort of a dim light, a little bit out of focus. But what does come into very sharp focus is the magnetism of Elvis, the way he related to the audience, the way he moved on stage, the way he actually became a part of his music. There's never been anyone like Elvis, and these films are very important in remembering the life of Elvis Presley.
Oh, see you right. Oh, see what you have done. Yeah. I said, see right. Oh, see what you have done. Yeah. Tell you, hey, love you. Won't be back. Hear what I say.
I think the most important thing is the inspiration that I got from a live audience. I was missing it.
Elvis hadn't appeared in New York City since his early television days in the late 50s. Colonel Tom Parker booked Madison Square Garden, and it was the next stop on his tour. Elvis, looking great, was ready for the New York press corps.
Can I get to sit down? First of all, I plead innocent of all charges.
Okay.
All right. Okay. Thank you, dear. Love you, too. Thank you. I don't know.
Elvis, what made you finally decide to come out of seclusion and start making public appearances again?
I just missed it. I missed the closeness of an audience, of a live audience. So just as soon as I got out of the movie contracts, I started to do live performances again.
Here it looks like you no longer have grease in your hair.
No, I stopped using that greasy kid stuff, too. Just like everybody else did, man.
You criticize so much for your long hair and your
razor.
You seem so modest now.
Man, I was tame compared to what they do now. Are you kidding? I didn't do anything. We just jiggle, you know. Yeah.
How do you feel about the way performers act on stage now compared to what you used to do and get criticized for?
Oh, I don't know. I really can't criticize anybody, in the entertainment field. I think there's room for everybody, and I hate to criticize another performer, you know.
Elvis, you look great. What's your secret? How do you stay in such good shape?
I take vitamin E. I was only kidding. I don't know. I just embarrassed myself, man. I don't know, dear. I enjoy the business. I like what I'm doing.
From a lot of people in the press corps that you're really a shy, humble, wonderful human being. Would you agree with that?
Oh, I don't know what makes them think that. You know, this gold belt and the... So am I. That's why I'm sitting down.
I can't walk out. Oh, because I love you.
How was it he came up with the idea for the white jumpsuits when he opened in Vegas in the late 60s?
Elvis used to have a lot of accidents on stage by splitting his pants. His pants were always tight, and he would constantly split his pants open. He wanted something that would be comfortable to wear on stage and still not have as many accidents as he has, and that he could do his moves in when he's performing.
Elvis, there's quite an evidence of sartorial splendor. Does this indicate that the...
What?
What? The attire is not one that we are familiar with seeing.
It's, it was taken from a karate suit. Just a regular karate-type outfit. Are they coming to get me? Is that it?
I mean, does this indicate that with your type of dress and everything, now that you're changing a little bit of style, perhaps, in deference to what you did a few years ago?
I don't know. I think that you'd have to see the show. You know, it's difficult to tell. I don't feel any different. You know, I don't think the dress has that much to do with it. I got the idea from a karate suit because I studied karate for a long time, and I had to make up a couple of suits like it.
What do you do for relaxation? You said you studied
karate. If you can relax doing this, I don't know.
I think it did come a little bit from a karate outfit because, you know, Elvis was big in karate. He started when he was in the army in Germany, and until the time he died, he was an 8th-degree black belt.
Elvis Presley's most favorite sport was the sport of karate. And we're going to share a few of those memories with one of his instructors, Master Khan Ri. Master Ri, exactly how interested was Elvis in karate?
He expressed to me... many times, music and karate is the most important in his life.
Exactly, Connery, how good was Elvis at karate?
He's this, spiritually a very, very strong point of the martial art. And he does so many different unique expressions about karate movement. He's using lots of eagle stance and then... a tiger stance and a cat stance on the stage, and he trying to lasso a side kick, a front kick. He's really impressed me first time I seen on the stage.
Elvis lived to be on stage. I mean, he's told me that many times. If he lost his voice or he couldn't sing anymore, he says he'd rather not even be on the earth. He says he lived to sing. And he was the happiest of all when he's on that stage for an hour, hour and a half.
Are you doing the thing? Hello, my very sweet chief.
One of the most famous stories concerning Elvis was when he decided to meet President Nixon. Longtime friend Jerry Schilling tells the story.
Elvis just kind of pushed us in and said, hey, guys, come on in. So we went in. Elvis introduced us to the president, and I mean, he took over. It was like we were at Graceland, not at the White House. So he said, Mr. President, they would like some of those keychains too, that, you know, you get, the president just given Elvis a presidential seal keychain. So the president went over and got that, and he came back and he said, well, you know, they got wives too. He had the president running around the White House. And it was, you know, it was really, there's where I knew that nobody could really say no to Elvis.
And I really should start this conference off by congratulating Elvis, because we will have two new firsts. The first new first involves Elvis as the first performer to do a worldwide live concert via satellite. A real spectacular. And the second is that we will have a worldwide album via satellite. All of this has been made possible by the joint efforts of a lot of people, and especially including Colonel Tom Parker. Elvis, again, my congratulations for this spectacular.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Elvis was the only star that could give a worldwide broadcast, and even the king was astounded.
It's very hard to comprehend it, because in 15 years, it's hard to comprehend that happening, you know.
How do you...
To all the countries all over the world via satellite. It's very difficult to comprehend. But it's my favorite part of the business, is a live concert.
How do you pace yourself?
Sir?
How do you pace yourself?
You mean physically, vocally, or whatever?
So you are up when you need to be up?
I just, I exercise every day. I vocalize every day. I practice if I'm working or not. No. So I just try to stay in shape all the time. Vocally and mentally. And
which is harder?
Well, both are tough, yeah. You got to work at them, but I don't mind it, you know. It's worth it.
And one time, shortly before he died, I was upstairs, and we were kind of reminiscing. And he said, Charlie said, look what we've done. He said, who would ever believe a little old guy from Mississippi and a little old guy from Alabama could do a show for the world?
That's beautiful.
I think that Elvis felt like, by God, maybe I can't preach. Maybe I can't take people and transfer them into something that will be good for them for a long time. But maybe through my concerts and my records, I can lighten their load just a little bit.
So many things, I guess, have been said, and which is so true, is about Elvis's generosity and his religiousness, that I'm happy to see more of it brought out instead of a lot of the bad things, you know. And because that's what I remember Elvis for, was the all of the happiness that he brought to people.
Well, I think a lot of people don't know that he was a shy person, and that's the reason he surrounded himself with his friends. That's the reason he didn't go out a lot. And I think that all those qualities go into the making of a superstar.
We were in California, and of course my father was diagnosed as having cancer. And I told Elvis about it, and of course it upset Elvis very much. He said, your place is at home with your father and with your mother. And he said, you go to that hospital every day just like you're working for me, and every Friday you go to Graceland and pick up your paycheck. And don't worry about nothing. And finally, we got to the point to where my father had not spoken a word in like 2 months. Christmas Eve, Elvis himself came up to the hospital and gave my father a pocket watch engraved for Christmas to him from Elvis. And I mean, made the trip up to the hospital itself. And my father rose up and spoke to Elvis. That's the last words he said.
Elvis
never hurt anyone, and he helped millions of people, and he might have hurt himself unintentionally.
I'm sure we all change as we grow older, you know, and Elvis couldn't remain a 19-year-old guy that got out of the Army, you know, like, or 21 or whatever, how old he was when he got out.
That's right.
But you just can't live that way forever. That was the image that everybody, I think, wanted to preserve of him. But he got into being an older person. He did more worldly things. He probably had a few drinks, and I don't know what else he did, but I hope he had a good time. That's the main thing, you know?
I think he did.
He deserved it. If ever a guy deserved to have a good time, he did. I don't care what it was.
Are you satisfied with the image you've established?
Well, the image is one thing, and a human being is another, you know. So...
How close does it come? How close does the image come to the man?
It's very hard to live up to an image, I'll put it that way. All right.
But I thought he was a very beautiful, and still is, a very beautiful person, and his memories shall probably forever live on.
And I remember vividly where I was, just as I do when we lost President Kennedy. I bet everyone knows where they were when they heard about Elvis Presley's passing.
The Junior Chamber of Commerce each year chooses the top 10 young men of America. In 1971, Elvis was chosen. And it was the first time in his career after becoming a superstar that he accepted an award in person.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to thank the JCs for electing me as one of the outstanding young men. When I was a child, ladies and gentlemen, I was a dreamer. And I read comic books, and I was the hero of the comic book. I saw movies, and I was the hero in the movie. So every dream that I ever dreamed has come true 100 times. And these gentlemen over here, you see these type of people who care, who are dedicated, you realize that it's not possible that they might be building the kingdom of heaven. It's not too far-fetched from reality. I'd like to say that I learned very early in life that without a song, the day will never end. Without a song, a man ain't got a friend. Without a song, the road will never bend. Without a song. So I'll keep singing a song. Good night. Thank you.
Memories sweeten through the ages just like wine. Apart with sweet memories.